Welcome to the Classy Ring Attire Podcast. I'm Joel.
I'm Chris.
And it's time to get classy.
Let's do it.
All right. So, on WCPW Loaded this week, how'd you feel the episode went?
I watched, like, the first two videos. And it seems like it's fine. I mean, like, I just kind of, like, got caught up with some other stuff, and I kind of forgot to watch the rest of it.
It's okay, yeah. In all honesty, it was the first episode. I think in principle, it's a great thing that they're doing. It's very much a put your money where your mouth is, especially especially because they have a series on what culture that is.
Well,
I would book it.
Well, I mean, it seemed like honestly, what culture seemed to like come out of nowhere, basically because of the how I would have booked videos.
Yeah.
And that was for a while. I think those were the only videos that they were doing for at least a month or so.
Yeah.
And then, you know, they started doing all this other stuff. And then kept doing the how I would book these things. And, you know, and it's something we've done on the podcast plenty of times, of how we would have done this or how we would have done that. Or I don't like how they did this, so here's how I would have done it. Like,
right.
Blah, blah, blah.
How did they miss this clear and obvious setup?
Sure. But none of us have, like, taken that and started our own wrestling promotion.
Yeah.
You know, so,
well,
kudos for them for having the balls to do that.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, part of that is, like, I don't have the money to start a wrestling promotion.
I mean, you're right. And I'll be the first one to admit, like, when I first heard that they're starting their own wrestling promotion, I got, like, the biggest of eye rolls. I'm like, really? Come on, you guys. Like, get your head out of your own butts. Like, but then, like, I thought about it, like, no, this is actually, like, this is kind of ballsy of them to do this. And they got, like, some pretty legit names to join in on this.
Yeah. As far as a review of the first episode, I think clearly all the money went to booking the talent.
Sure.
Which is, I mean, what you do, like, especially if you're starting off. There was some audio issues.
Sure.
And that wasn't just me saying that. Like, that was a pretty consistent complaint about it.
Right.
There's no microphone on the bell.
Right.
Which is something like if I was in charge,
I never
would not have occurred to me, because I'm sure that bell sounded fine and dandy in that
live
room.
Yeah.
And then like, so watching, I was like, what is that?
Or it can just be like Japan and just have a wood block.
But like it's stuff that is fine and totally
right.
First episode.
Sure.
They're figuring it out. So there's some audio issues. There was some green screen that they've already said is not going to be happening. It wasn't intended to happen this time.
Right.
And it won't be happening again. They've already got it fixed and worked out.
Cool.
I thought the What Culture guys melded into their parts really well.
Right.
The commentaries, a little, like, they need to work on it a little bit.
Sure, yeah.
But again, that feels like just first episode issues.
Again, like, what experience do they have? Like, this is how they get experience. This is how they, you know,
exactly
critique themselves.
And, like, it's not like there's a shining pinnacle of commentary on WWE every week to be like, oh, if only, why can't they do that?
Right.
But King Ross really won me over.
He did?
Yeah.
All right, fair enough.
Like, and he's going to, like, it's pretty much something where, like, he's either going to be like, people are like, he won me over, or it's going to be like, that's the worst part of the show.
Sure.
And I totally get that.
Right.
And I never watched any, like, if he was the host of a video, I'm not watching that video. I don't really care what this dude. But, like, it worked for me in sort of a heel commentator role.
Right.
So.
Yeah. Yeah, I think I saw a tweet by Matthew Gregg, the guy that does all the Bacha Mania videos.
Mm-hmm.
And he was there for the taping. And, like, he immediately, like, tweeted something along the lines of, like, yeah, I was expecting all of the What Culture guys to be jerks, but they're not. Like, he just kind of felt deflated about that.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're decent people. So, I mean, you know, I wish them all the luck. Like, obviously the British wrestling scene has been kind of taking off.
Right.
So hopefully, like, that this is only, you know, helps that.
Well, there's,
I mean, because there's, like, a handful of, like, British wrestlers that we are now starting to know, like, you know, Zack Sabre Jr., who's in the the cruiserweight thing, and got, you know, Will Ospreay, who had a match against Ricochet that set the internet on fire, and WWE apparently really wanted for the cruiserweight thing, but couldn't, you know, maneuver around. They couldn't maneuver around his new Japan deal.
Yeah,
but I mean, that's two wrestlers, and there's plenty more where that came from that we're just now kind of like, you know, us, you know, Westerners.
I know it's one episode old, but like, I don't see if there's any reason why what culture couldn't grow into the biggest British, you know.
I mean, I know company. Revolution Pro, I think, is the other, like, the big.
That's the big one right now.
Right. But they don't have, like, a following like what culture does, especially, like, with, like, a universally accessible medium like YouTube.
Right.
You know? It is one of those things where, like, I mean, I'm not going to say that they cornered the market on this, because right here in our own backyard, CWF Mid-Atlantic has been putting up weekly episodes on YouTube for a while now.
At least a year?
Yeah. And, you know, it's working out very well for them, but then again, like, they don't have, like, they didn't have the platform that what culture did, you know, leading into it.
I mean, there's the idea of, like, I'll make my own weekly show and put up episodes on YouTube is nothing new. Like, I've had more than one, you know, YouTube wormhole where I've gone down and I've found, like, backyard wrestling.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Like, 212 views on a match, no ring, literally in a backyard. And then, like, this, we should use a power saw for a weapon. I'm like, no. It might be the difference between, like, 212 and 215 views. It's not worth it. Don't power saw your friend.
Sure, yeah. Yeah, it's a market that I'm surprised bigger, you know, promotions haven't, you know, done right. I mean, the majority of it is everyone's aiming for a TV deal.
Right.
Because that's where a lot of the money, especially the advertisement.
Well, okay.
But if you know how to maneuver around all this stuff, like, you can make plenty of advertising money on YouTube.
It's the kind of thing where you kind of got to go, who wants that? Like, honestly, YouTube would not be a bad step for, like, TNA to go.
Right?
Because
everyone can find YouTube. Not everyone can find Pop TV.
Exactly. They probably, you know, have the same amount of advertising dollars. TNA's biggest things recently have been YouTube videos with the Hardy Boys.
Yeah.
I mean,
for better or worse, yeah.
That's what's gotten people talking about TNA more than anything else is YouTube videos. But there's this stigma of, like, We were on TV, and now we're on YouTube.
Sure.
We're a shallow shell of our former self.
Right, it's that transition that kind of feels, but in all honesty, like, it's more accessible, and it makes more sense. So there shouldn't be any sort of stigma of, like, you know, going from TV to YouTube, you know, but really it should be like, oh, they're thinking ahead, like, that's pretty smart, because you know how much it costs to upload something on YouTube, and we know from experience, that answers nothing.
Yeah.
It costs $0, you know? I mean, sure, you have to make up costs for, like, production and everything, but that's, again, like, if you can get advertisement and, you know, and people on board for that, like, you're set.
Well, the thing is, like, I couldn't watch TNA if I wanted to. I don't get that channel.
Yeah, I don't have cable. Like, neither of us have cable.
Like, I hear, you know, oh, that happened on TNA. All right.
I'll find a clip of it on YouTube.
Let me wait for...
If I need to watch it, yeah.
Yeah. Let me wait for the Hardy Boys to make another Gonzo experimental film.
Jeez. So yeah, like, I'm honestly surprised that, especially, like, you know, TNA doesn't have, like, a YouTube presence as far as, like, their weekly, you know, storyline. Now, like, if it's a promotion that does mostly just, you know, just your special events, like, a lot of promotions, like, all right, we'll have a show on this date, and then next time you see us is, you know, on this show a month later, like, stuff like that. That doesn't necessarily have week-to-week stuff, then sure, fine. And I guess what CWF Mid-Atlantic does is they, you know, they basically do all these big dates, well, just like that, but they'll chop it up and then kind of weave a storyline through it, which is which is, you know, the smartest way to go. NXT does it their own way, you know?
Yeah.
Honestly, like, I'm surprised. Well, I was going to say Ring of Honor, but I think they're still, like, sitting pretty in Destination America, aren't they? Last I heard.
They're on TV still.
Yeah.
Destination America? I don't remember what channel it's
because, on. Because they got to Destination America after TNA, and they were happier with Ring of Honor than they...
Right, right. That's all coming back to me.
Yeah. So I don't know, but, like, there's plenty of these promotions that are right on the verge that would benefit greatly if they were, like, the YouTube promotion. And that might be, you know, what culture, like, that might be their thing now.
Yeah, the thing is, like, I think what culture, they already had the you know, 2 feet in the water. And so all they got to do is put out a good product. And
sure. Yeah. Content is king.
Yeah, like, the thing is, they're one for one on that. Like,
sure.
It was a solid episode. I'm going to watch it next week,
mm-hmm.
you know? Because, like, there was a very real possibility that, like, I was going to turn on and be like, oh, this is garbage.
Sure.
Like, here's the thing. That I did that for NXT. Very beginning, like, you know, we're replacing ECW with this NXT
sure.
thing. Watch it. Like, all right,
NXT season one?
Oh,
yeah.
This is garbage.
And then it took us 4 seasons to come back just because, guys, they're doing some weird stuff on NXT now.
Yeah. And you know what? I think I watched at least the first episode of every season where I was
sure.
like, all right, nope, still garbage.
Right. Just kind of check in on it.
Mm-hmm. And I would, like, you know, peter in and out of it, but, like, that didn't happen here. That, so they put on a solid show. Every issue that I have, they seem to be aware of it, which is
sure.
more than I can say for WWE. Like, you know, I have plenty of, like, here's some issues, and they're like, those aren't issues.
Right.
But here I'm like, they're like, yeah, they're issues. We're working on. I'm like, okay.
Right. Yeah.
Let's
yeah.
go. Let me watch another episode.
It's like on Irrelevant But Awesome's YouTube page, IBA Studios, if you're looking for it. We've got our Pokemon videos. It was back when I had, you know, less than great audio equipment, and so the audio is not great. And I think the last one was put up this week. And even in the video description, I was like, guys, I promise episode number 7 is going to have fixed audio. I promise it. Like, because there's no avoiding it.
Yeah.
And that's kind of, like, always been, like, the mentally appalling thing of WWE. He's like, guys, just say you messed up and fix it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, it costs you nothing, but all it would do is probably help you.
Yeah.
If you just acknowledge, like, yeah, sure, yeah, we messed up on this, and here's how we're going
to
fix it.
Well, there's so many things where just to be like, okay, we're working on it.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? That doesn't mean it has to be perfect next time. Like, stuff's a work in progress. Putting out, you know, content every
mm-hmm.
week, every day, every whatever, you know, when you have a deadline like that for your content, sometimes, you know, you can't fix every problem in a week, but to be aware of that, to be constantly working on it,
sure,
is really all I can ask as a fan.
Yeah.
So I'm not going into the next, I'm not like, you know, all right, I saw one episode and they'll fix everything and now
sure,
choosing
yeah, yeah. different.
No, there'll be some more issues. There'll probably be some of the same issues.
Right. And there might be new issues, like, just happen to pop up. But those things happen.
The stuff that I found super charming with King Ross last week might get grating. Like,
yeah.
you know, there's a very fine line. And not only might that happen, that probably will happen.
Sure.
There's a very, very fine line between hilariously annoying heel commentator and just plain annoying heel commentator.
Right.
And the only way you find it is crossing that line
right.
and being like, oh, okay, I got to back up, got to fix
right.
it. So I can almost promise you that something like that will happen within the next 5-6 episodes.
Mm-hmm.
But that's fine because they're working on it. Also, very kind of cool little note, they very clearly are performing – The in-ring performers,
mm-hmm.
both the wrestlers and the What Culture guys, are very clearly performing for the audience present.
Sure, yeah.
Which is something, like, WWE doesn't. WWE is performing for the cameras.
Right.
The audience is scenery. It's for
and
the
And that's the biggest reason why a lot of guys go to NXT first, because they're, you know, people that have never tried to work to the camera.
Right.
You know? And so that's the big transition thing, is working to the camera, both in your entrance and in the ring.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And, you know, some of that sometimes is a bummer. Like, we were at the Raw where the Time Machine happened, New Day's Time Machine, and We just saw the back of the time machine.
Right.
Because where we sat, because that wasn't for us, it was for the cameras.
Sure.
But it's nice to see, even if like, oh, I'm not getting the ideal, you know, shot that's sure. super pretty. It's nice to see. I like that, you know, they're clearly there for the people present.
Right, yeah. That, so. I've got no issue with that. But it's probably something that they're going to eventually have to adjust for.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
because
yeah.
That's your biggest potential audience, mm-hmm. you know.
Well, finding that balance is...
Sure, important. Oh, yeah. This is slightly wrestling-related, but it's just something that I just kind of want to get off my chest. Man voting is overrated, that I'm starting to learn. And it make, like, just seeing, like, the... I'm not trying to get political here, but I'm just seeing the terrible choices that are being made out of people voting lately. It's made me really, really, really happy that WWE doesn't do, like, pick who's, you know, going to match up against each other next. Like, it's really, like, refreshing that they gave up on that.
It's like, how are you trying to tie this back in?
Yeah. God forbid if they ever, like, you know, they do another, like, Raw from the UK show.
Yeah.
And they do, like, fan vote, you know, who's going to fight John Cena? Is it going to be Seth Rollins, Dean Ambrose, Roman Reigns? And then everyone picks, like, no, we just vote for Roman Reigns to just leave the country. Like, he's no long part of the WWE Union. You know? Like, it's stuff like that. I just wanted to throw that out there. Just, it has nothing to do with anything. But just the thought I wanted to get off my chest. I'm really, like, there's very few things where I'm like, you know what? I'm glad WWE... is doing this or not doing this, you know what I mean? Especially when it comes to, like, voting stuff, because usually it's pretty cringeworthy.
You know what? They weren't Team Friendship. So that would have been the thing. That would have been right. Like, nope, you don't get a say anymore.
Yeah.
You stupid, flawed.
See, okay. All right. See, Team Hell No is leave. Team Friendship is stay. There you go. There's your analogy right there, folks.
I'm trying to keep his wrestling centralized.
Well, yeah, but I wanted to also, like, tie in everything that I just said.
All right.
So, there's a little bow. Let's move on. A little bit, yeah.
All right. So, now let's talk about the rest of wrestling that we have to talk about.
Okay, bigger one, off the bat.
Sorry, what culture was, like, the thing I was more interested in this week? Because it was new and shiny.
It's new, yeah. But the biggest thing WWE... on that island, Seth Rollins in his opening promo with Raw just flat out
just yammered on about Roman Reigns.
It's like, I'm not supposed to talk about it, but I'm going to talk about it, which clearly means he was told that he could talk about it. Yeah, obviously. But still, it's like, all right, WWE is going against his own protocol once again, so they're eager to get that shock value, I guess.
I like that we have this big, grand mystery of, like, is Roman Reigns in trouble? Like, we know right. He's not going to be there for 30 days.
Right.
But is he going to get, like, de-pushed when he gets back? Is he going to, like, is it just going to be like, here, Dean, hold the champion for a month because we're giving it back to Roman the second he gets back?
And honestly, the answer to that question won't be answered until, you know, Battleground. But, man, that was weird. Mm-hmm. You know? And, like, Seth Rollins, like, you know, knocked it out of the park with that promo.
Well, that was... honestly, like, once it had happened and I saw it, I was like, that was the best way to handle that.
Sure.
They can't...
Like
they can't ignore it. They can't be like, you know, like nobody acknowledged Roman for 30 days.
Like, what we were saying just, you know, a few minutes ago with what culture is, like, when they saw a mistake, they addressed it, be like, okay, this is what we're going to fix. You know, usually, 9 times out of 10, WWE's method is just ignore it. Yeah. And that's exactly with this. Like, usually, like, they wouldn't touch it at all. They wouldn't even talk about Roman Reigns. They would, which is weird, seeing as how he's still booked in their main event, mm-hmm. you know. But, and see, that I guess that was, they kind of forced to talk about it then, you know.
Right.
Because 9 times out, like, again, almost all the time, if somebody is booked in some sort of storyline, and then they get suspended for whatever reason, they just throw that whole storyline under the rug, like, and just move on.
Mm-hmm.
But here, from what we talked about last week, they knowingly A, suspended him, and B, like,
put him in their next
put him event. In their main event knowing they were going to suspend him. Like, it's just a lot of question marks of, like, why would you do that?
Which plays into the grand mystery, is Roman in trouble?
Sure. And then, like, there was a story going around on Reddit a couple days ago about how the EVP of Talent Relations, Mark Carano, like, basically told Roman Reigns to go in the locker room and apologize to all the guys and before he was sent home.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, okay, well, that has Triple H's fingerprints all over it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just a weird thing, because, like, half of the roster was like, yeah, man, don't worry about it. And the other half was like, that's messed up. They made him do that. You know, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a long string of, like, what is going on?
Who is mad at him, and why are they mad at him? Because here's the thing with Triple H,
mm-hmm.
I can see it. Triple H laid down for Roman.
Sure.
And Triple H doesn't do that for a lot of people.
No.
With Triple H, like, you know, personal feelings on the match quality aside, Triple H lost to Roman clean, sure. Middle of the ring, 1-2-3, at the biggest WrestleMania of all time.
Right.
That's a big deal. Well, you don't do that for just anybody.
Well, beyond that, think of it this way. Who has been, like, protected more in the past year and a half than Roman Reigns? You know? Mm-hmm. It seems like they've gone out of their way to both push him and, you know, when that didn't work in the eyes of the fans, they tried their best to make it work, to get the fans to turn, to finally cheer for this man. They've tried so hard for a year and a half, like, painstakingly, almost to the detriment of the company, mm-hmm. you know? They had the fans booing the entire fifth hour of WrestleMania, even though WWE was, like, trying, like, come on, you guys. And then he's in their top spot now, and he gets popped for a wellness policy violation, whatever it actually was.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's got to be, like, A, frustrating, and B, just really just... frustrating is probably the only word. Like, I don't, like, it would piss me off.
Yeah.
Like, dude, we've catered to you because we believe in you for the last year and a half. Like, the past year and a half, the story has been Roman Reigns, Roman Reigns, Roman Reigns.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
But just to throw a wrench into this, Roman Reigns is... It's safe to assume... And this is mostly rumors, and nobody has...
Sure.
Nobody reputable has confirmed it, but it's not a crazy outlandish claim. But there's been several rumors that Roman Reigns is not happy with his character. He knows he's getting booed. He doesn't like going out there and getting booed.
Oh, sure.
And he wants to, if not turn heel, at least change his character
mm-hmm.
enough so that he can, you know... Be
and that might have
be
been
big whole, and bad and not yeah. want to care about the food.
Because there was a like a noticeable slight shift the night after WrestleMania.
Right.
And he's kind of been on that. So that might have been like as far as they were willing to go with it
mm-hmm.
to, you know, satiate his desire to turn heel.
Yeah.
Or close to it. So you're thinking the wellness policy was the way to
No, but I'm just saying that if their whole being frustrated at Roman Reigns is, we've done all this for you, Roman Reigns' response is kind of like, well, you did it for you and you made me do it too, because I didn't want that.
Sure, yeah,
I wanted,
yeah.
you know, this different career path that you're not letting
me. Oh, yeah, like, no, from the...
Not in a, like, so now I
oh, yeah.
get, and you know, this, but...
I wouldn't discredit that at all. I mean, look at the, like, just look at the guy at WrestleMania 32. Like, he looked like he just did not want to be there. From the get-go, like, he just, and I'm like, dude, like, this is, like, your main eventing for the second year in a row mm-hmm. at the biggest WrestleMania ever, no matter what the fudge numbers may say, it's still the biggest ever, like, why the sad face, Panda Bear, like, that kind of thing, like, come, yeah, I had to bring it up, and it's just like, come on, dude, like, you're not gonna win the fans over if you're just, you know, stink-eyeing everybody,
yeah.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's a very real possibility.
So, he comes back heel, right? Like, that makes so much sense.
If he doesn't, I don't know, man. If this keeps going for much longer, he's going to be, like, one of the most jaded, like, He's like one of those jaded, like one of those like old, old timers, like one of the, you know, former WWE guys that just hates the, like, not hates the fan, but just doesn't want anything to do with the fans at all.
Yeah.
Because of stuff like this. Mm-hmm. You know? It's stuff like this that I'm surprised that Batista even puts up with anybody on social media, you know? I feel like Roman Reigns is going to be like going towards that. We're just like, I don't want anything to do with you guys.
Yeah.
I'm going to collect my paycheck and, you know, go on from there. Like, you know, Randy Orton.
Yeah. I mean, we've said, and there's, you know, we don't need to spend a whole lot of time rehashing. Rock needed a heel run to become The Rock.
Sure.
Without that heel run, he's nothing. He's Rocky Maivia, the interesting footnote.
Right.
And Roman Reigns needs that heel run.
Like,
all of his character-based talents seem to be stemming out of that heelish potential.
Yeah.
But for whatever reason, it hasn't happened yet. And
sure.
So do you think we're not making predictions tonight, but if we're making predictions tonight, who would you think? Okay, who do you think is going to win the Battleground main event? And do you think the winner is walking out with the title?
Well, I'm going to go ahead and say yes to the second question.
Okay.
Winner will... It's Roman.
You think so?
Yeah. Just out of, like, the law of averages. Just, like, you know, they haven't really, like... They've had him lose one match... One singles match, at least, or second pay-per-view, I guess. Yeah, this is only second pay-per-view of the year where he's lost a match, Royal Rumble, but that almost doesn't really count. So it's just, I'm going to keep probably picking Roman until, like, he stops winning on a consistent basis.
Okay.
I'm not happy about it, but...
New question.
Mm-hmm.
If Triple H was in charge... If something happens to Vince between now and Battleground, and Triple H becomes like, you know what? Vince is, you know, confined to a bed without a phone for his own health reasons.
Mm-hmm.
Triple H, you're running the company for the next 6 months.
Who do I have one?
Yeah.
Dean Ambrose.
So you think it's...
I think, honestly, like, working that closely with Dean... through the whole roadblock thing, I think that put a big, like, he was already, you know, pretty big and positive on Dean Ambrose as it was.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like that only helped that. And when Triple H sees Roman, I think Triple H sees probably a little bit of himself, because, like, he's, you know, been in those shoes before, in the sense of this is his 1995, the Madison
curtain call. Okay, but take the curtain call, for example.
Yeah.
He was going to win that King of the Ring, and that was taken from him specifically as punishment for this curtain call moment.
Mm-hmm.
And not just the King of the Ring situation, but he really, his push got put on the back burner for 6 months to a year.
Sure.
Do you think hugging a friend... in 1995 is worse than substance abuse violation in 2016?
In this day and age, yes, and I'll tell you why. Because that curtain call was viewed as by a lot of individuals in the company as highly offensive in the terms of, you know, keeping the business alive, like kayfabe and everything. Like, this is what they did. Was a big slap in the face to the culture. Not only, like, just not even just the wrestlers that are there, but just the history and the culture of their profession. Granted, like, that might have been, like, you know, kind of taken a little bit too far in that, like, but also from the aspect of these were two guys who were leaving to a rival company, you know. Why are you rolling the red carpet out for them when they're leaving us? You know, that kind of thing.
Okay.
So if that happened today, not that big a deal. The you know, thanks to the internet and everybody else, like, the business is blown wide open and we're still fans of it. So it clearly didn't ruin the business. That same, like I said, like, with people getting angry that so much was put into Roman, and he did this, he was dumb enough to use some sort of banned substance, is pretty, if I was one of the higher-up guys in WWE that put a lot of effort into this,
mm-hmm.
I would have been offended. I would have been disappointed and offended. Now, I'm not saying it's, you know, irreparable. Like, clearly he can, like, you know, like Triple H, when he got suspended, he had to start from the bottom. And mm-hmm. because he had that drive and he had the talent, which is something that a lot of people don't like to acknowledge, but the guy is full of talent. Like, clearly, I still, like, say what you want about, you know, how he, you know, pulls strings behind, that's what you got to do.
Yeah.
But he also has the talent to go along with it. He's mm-hmm. not, Triple H was not a talentless hack and still isn't, you know? Yeah.
There's a reason Vince is a one-time champion.
Right.
And not a whatever Triple H is.
14?
Is he 14 times?
Yeah. And sure, some of those title wins were political. It happens. Whatever. Mm-hmm. You think Shawn Michaels' title wins weren't political? Come on. The guy, you know, he probably pulled the same strings that Triple H did.
Yeah.
But if he was a talentless hack that didn't deserve the spot that he was given, there's no way that he would have brought himself back from 1995. You know what I mean? Because he was kind of like, a lot of people could say, like, he was getting that initial push probably because of his relation with Shawn Michaels and you know, the click and everything, you know. And so when he got put back at the bottom on his own and started, like, building himself back up, you know, he did so kind of, like, on his own merit. Now, of course, he got, you know, put back with Shawn around 1997, but at the same time, like, in between that point, he took his medicine and he kept going.
Mm-hmm.
So, I feel like, because honestly, a 30-day vacation doesn't feel like punishment enough. And again, it all depends on exactly what was the violation.
Part of what came out of this was, hey, you remember all that time that CM Punk begged to take a break and they were saying, no, you have to come out? It's a shame he was straight edge, because he could have gotten him a 30-day vacation real quick.
At least the first time, then a 60-day vacation.
There you go.
It's like staying with the company for like 5 years and getting like an additional week of vacation time. But it's 30 days doesn't feel like enough of a punishment. Depending on exactly what it was. If it was like something that Adam Rose's initial suspension, it was, you know, kind of a bogus situation where it was, like, something that his doctor gave him that he was told would, you know, it was something that wasn't any sort of, like, PED or steroid or anything like that. Like, it was, like, something for, like, a health, like, legitimate health reason.
Right.
And it just happened to contain a substance that he was unaware of. Which, you know, kind of, like, smells like BS, but at the same time, like, I can kind of see where that happens.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel like you should do your due diligence and really research everything you take, especially if you're under that big of a microscope.
Your livelihood depends on it.
Sure. But if it's a situation where he just didn't think he was going to get caught, that kind of thing, start him back from the bottom. And let's see if he has the talent to build himself back up.
I mean, I could be wrong, but I feel like Roman is going to have to... They're going to pull back for Roman a little for this.
Yeah.
And
if pulling back for Roman means, like, he's back, like, competing for mid-card belts, fine.
Yeah.
You know, because I'm not going to, like, sit here and pretend that WWE is going to keep him off TV after his suspension's done. Like, they're going to have him on the TV. Like, he makes a dent in merchandise sales. Like, I'm not saying he does great, but he makes a dent in it. So, like, he's still, like, a profitable entity for them.
But he's missing the draft.
Yes.
Which is interesting, because I feel like he was going to be one of the big picks. Like, you know, it was him and Cena.
Right, yeah.
So.
I still think he's going to go, like, him and Cena are still, like, 1 and 2.
Yeah.
Whether he's there or not.
So, do you think they'll talk about him at the draft? Like, and now that they've acknowledged that he's not there for this suspension, he'll be back at this date.
Sure. Because that would be the last, like, TV show that he misses is the draft.
Right.
Because that is technically the go-home show to Battleground.
Right.
And he's back to live events that weekend.
There's no reason that, like, whoever is doing the, you know, drafting can, they can discuss, like, yeah, Roman's not here now, but he's still a worthy choice, and he's going to be my pick.
Sure, yeah. I mean, I'm pretty sure somebody's going to say something to that effect.
Yeah.
I just don't know exactly how they're going to handle
it. Have you played the fantasy draft?
Very quickly. I found myself kind of, and maybe this is just unfair to SmackDown, but it's like, I like that person, Raw. I don't really care for that person, SmackDown. And it kind of did that. And then, like, for a while, I was like, I don't really care one way or the other. So, my current draft rosters are kind of lopsided. So, you go on whichever has less, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So, everybody that I like is all on Raw. And everyone that I either dislike or don't really care one way or the other, SmackDown.
I did the exact opposite of you.
Everything that you like,
everything I like goes to SmackDown.
Fair enough.
Because SmackDown's a 2-hour show.
Fair enough.
And I would rather watch a 2-hour show than
but
a
3-hour
show. But
in the end, was it pretty much even? Like, it was an odd number, so one had more than the other. But
yeah, I didn't really pay attention to, like, numerical things.
Yeah. See, I was sitting here trying to be fair. By giving SmackDown all the people that are crap.
No, I mean, I started off like the first three, which were like John Cena, AJ Styles, and Seth Rollins.
Yeah.
I think Dean Ambrose might have been four, which, like,
yeah.
Champions, number four seed in the draft.
Sure, yeah.
All right. Like,
I did do the whole, like, you know, Cena on SmackDown, Roman on Raw, that kind of thing. Because because the guy that they're presumably going to stay behind for the next few years probably should be on their A show.
Yeah.
So put Cena on SmackDown. He can rule SmackDown.
But yeah, like, the first three or four, which is basically Cena, AJ, Seth Rollins, and Dean Ambrose. Like, I sat and I was like agonizing. I was like, I'm putting it. And after that, I was like, oh, this is losing the appeal. Yeah, I didn't really pay attention to the numbers and, like,
SmackDown got Ryback.
Ryback's in the thing, which is interesting.
It made me curious, yeah. But, like, also they didn't have any NXT people.
Neville was not in the thing, which I don't think is that alarming because he's probably, like, a surprise return.
He might be, like, a surprise inclusion into the draft, and that's kind of how they bring him in.
Yeah.
Especially a lot with the NXT people. Like, you know, they're going to try to make this as suspenseful as possible, so.
I mean, I got to say, like, I'm really looking forward to, like, the more they tease it, the more I'm looking forward to the draft.
Yeah, the more I'm intrigued by it, yeah.
Well, just, I wasn't here for the original split and the original draft.
Mm-hmm.
That was in my lapsed time. So the drafts, as I know them, are the little, like, lottery drafts.
Oh, sure.
Which weren't that much fun to watch.
Yeah.
Like, they were cool, and they were better episodes than, like, your run-of-the-mill Raw episode.
Yeah.
And they also, like, because they meant lasting change was happening. Let's see what's happening here. But there was no rhyme or reason, and it wasn't bad, but it felt like there was so much potential you could do with a draft storyline.
Yeah.
And so it looks like it's coming.
Yeah. Interesting note, though. July 11th is the start date of the Cruiserweight thing, right? Uh-huh. Also is the day that Finn Balor versus Nakamura airs on NXT. And it's also 1 week before the draft.
Huh.
I feel like that's good timing, especially for Finn Balor.
You think he's getting drafted?
Oh, yeah. I feel like if there's any, like, given, I feel like it's Finn.
Do you think he goes
I don't know
the
exactly.
The club?
Honestly, like, now that they've got them with AJ, like, I think he's kind of cool, like, good to just stick on his own, you know?
Yeah.
And I kind of want him to stick on his own. Like, I don't, and again, like I said, like, I don't know how he does his entrance, the demon gimmick, as a heel.
Yeah, I don't know, like, and I get that.
Especially initially.
But I just, there's this thing where, like, the Bullet Club is so much better than that club.
Oh, absolutely.
And the Balor Club was a nice little substitute where you still, like, get to do it. It's your own thing, and we made it up, and it's not a copy of this. Where we all know it is, and we can all just, like, pretend, like, no, sure, WWE, you did make up a cool thing.
Even though his t-shirt says bulletproof.
So.
Yeah.
I was looking forward to the concept of Ballet Club.
Yeah.
But that's okay.
That's okay. They've just got the club now.
Yeah.
I mean, they can still go down that route, you know, but I'm very much okay with Balor on his own. I think he'll do just
Balor's on his own. I think heel AJ is entertaining me far more than I thought he would.
Sure, yeah.
Somehow, against all odds, heel Jericho has like wrenched it back from like sad cool dad territory that he was in for so long.
Yeah.
To just being a delight.
Yeah.
I really dug the highlight reel this week.
It's like it took him a while to finally, like, this is what 2016 heel Jericho would be.
Yeah.
You know, and, you know, kudos to him to, like, continuing to, like, search for it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because a lot of guys are just like, all right, well, maybe the same thing will work this week, you know?
I mean, I was so done with that at WrestleMania. Like, WrestleMania area.
Have you noticed Jericho's scarves just keep getting longer and longer?
Yeah.
The one from Raw was absurd.
They're getting super ridiculous.
Like, it went down to his knees.
But, like, the whole on the ladder thing. Where he won an apple. The highlight reel, this thing. Like, Jericho has come back from the brink for me. I was so ready to be like, Jericho is desperate need of retirement. But I'm still not super looking forward to him wrestling because I don't know how much he has left to go there.
Wait, is he too big of a name to be a manager?
I almost...
At least, like, right now.
I almost feel like he would need to be injured to be a manager.
Okay.
And he would be a great guy if, like, they, you know, if they could, like, you know, in kayfabe break his wrist,
mm-hmm.
And then he has that cast, you know, bring back the old cast as a weapon.
Right. The old thing where a manager has to have some sort of weapon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So Jericho can't wrestle because he's injured, but he has this cast weapon.
You know who he would be a great manager for?
Who?
Ty Dillinger. I feel like they would go along quite well. Not just because they're both Canadian.
I could see that.
Yeah.
But no, if I had to manage, if I had to turn Chris Jericho into manager, I would kayfabe break his wrist.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Gives him the weapon, gives him a reason why he can't wrestle.
Right.
Also, threatening people with a cast is totally something heel Jericho would do.
Do you think Cowboy Bob Orton would, like, accuse him of stealing his gimmick?
I mean,
because he had a broken wrist for like a decade.
Yeah, no, it's clearly the Cowboy Bob Orton thing, but like you get to recycle things every 7 years, right?
Yeah, that one's been long overdue. Mm-hmm. Although they did bring him back for like one time, and he had a cast on his arm just so he could hit somebody with it.
So, I mean, pass the cast along to somebody else.
Oh, sure.
It's not like Sting invented the baseball bat.
True. Yeah, that just reminded me of Seth Rollins' axe handle.
God, I hate that axe handle.
It was so dumb.
I hate that.
Good times, you guys.
Did anything else really big happen on Raw this week?
No.
Like,
I don't think so.
Not really.
Nothing that I'm like eager to discuss.
Delve into. Yeah, like really get to the meat of.
But really, it ended up turning into us talking about Roman again, about a suspension.
It's the biggest story, and it's because is Roman in trouble?
Mm-hmm.
Is he like in real trouble, or is he slap on the wrist trouble? And we won't know it until he comes back and we see how he is handled.
Yeah.
But, you know, we have years of, you know, what Vince's decision in the past to try and guess.
Sure, yeah. Yeah, the past week has really just been about two news stories, and that's, like, you know, the continuing coverage of Roman Reigns' suspension and Brexit. And we've covered both, so, all right, go for us.
What's making you happy?
Oh, man, I had that ready for last week, and now I completely forgot. what's making you happy, Joel?
Wrestling-related, what's making me happy? First of all, this is a continuation. It won't count as my thing, since it's basically a continuation of previous weeks.
Sure.
But with the Cruiserweight coming up, people are continuing to talk about these guys. I've seen at least two different posts on Reddit that were like, hey, if you're interested in these guys, here is a list of matches to familiarize yourself. So going down YouTube holes of Cruiserweight guys is making me happy.
Sure.
That's been a previous week thing. But the fact that, like, people are doing all the search work for me, really helpful. Thank you. Appreciate it. The other thing is the Jake the Snake Roberts documentary is on Netflix.
You finally got around to watching it?
I watched part of it, and I'm going to finish it up the second we finished recording this.
Have you seen the cameo?
So I've not seen a cameo yet.
Our buddy Rhett Davis is in. Him and his dad make a cameo. His dad is the one talking, and Rhett's kind of like standing there. But
I don't know if I've seen that. I forgot to look for
it. It was kind of a weird thing that I kind of a weird Facebook message dance that I did with him, because it was like really late at night, and I was really just had it on in the background while I was trying to sleep, and I ended up like not really being able to sleep. So it was kind of like a half drowsy, you know, viewing of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sitting there like, wow, this is both like good and a little depressing, but still really good. And then, like, you know, I saw this talking cat, and I was like, that looks like a costume that I saw on a photo on Facebook of Rhett and his dad at WrestleMania that one year. Wait, is that Rhett? And then, like, the next morning, like, half unsure of what I watched, but I was at work, so I couldn't, like, watch it again just for that.
Mm-hmm.
So I, like, messaged Rhett, and it's like, hey, bud, just watch the just watched the Jake the Snake documentary. Waited for a response. Waited a few hours for a response. He was like, his response was basically, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I could have swore that I saw someone that looked like you and your dad that one time. Yeah, that was totally us. I knew it! You know that whole thing?
Yeah.
So you're going to finish it.
Yeah, but it's on Netflix, so check it out if you get a chance. It's easy to watch now.
Absolutely.
It's a little interesting because I'm a little more detached from like these guys because they were the old timers when I started watching. Sure. So now that, you know, it was not in their prime.
The Iron Sheik documentary is also really good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've seen that one. But and there's like there's starting to be there. It feels like there's starting to be a documentary for each guy. Like Jake the Snake has one, she has one. They're making a 30 for 30 for Ric Flair.
Right.
So like just. One by one, all these guys are going to get their documentary.
Oh, yeah.
But so I just...
Waiting on Undertakers.
I'm digging the fact that it is becoming more and more the norm for these guys to get documentaries that are not the hand-selected WWE version of the story.
Because, you know, a lot of them have, like... It's one thing that I learned from the Bruiser Brody book is that just there's so many stories from so many different people that you... that aren't at the forefront of your, you know, your consciousness at all times. Like, and, you know, WWE is like, all right, well, here's all of our roster just sharing their thoughts. I'm like, these are, like, they're talking about people that they probably never met, or they met, like, one time, maybe just shook his or her hand.
Right.
You know? I want stories of people who actually, like, know these people, but not, that aren't necessarily in the, you know, best of terms with WWE either. Yeah. Like,
no, and, like, I don't want to knock the WWE documentary series because for the most part they've, especially in recent years, especially in the last 5 years or so, they put out some very solid, well-researched, in-depth things, but there is so much out there, and the fact that like that we are finally starting to get to archive that in big mass, so is making me
The main emphasis behind documentary is, like, the truth behind it. Like, and nothing is off limits. Like, you want the complete truth of this subject.
Mm-hmm.
And anytime you're in a situation where, like, we can't really, like, touch on these few years because they're within a company that we don't, like, own.
Yeah.
So we can't really talk to them. Like, and at that point, it's just like, it's kind of like, I don't want to say it's cheapening it. Because, again, like, you put on a completely good documentary and just not even touch those things, but still, like, there's clearly something missing here.
Well, WWE put out some solid Sting retrospectives.
Sure, yeah.
I don't think WWE is going to make the definitive Sting documentary.
No.
There is a definitive Sting documentary to be made that really delves into a lot of stuff that WWE won't touch.
Right.
I mean, like, not even WCW, because they have all that, but, like...
Oh, sure. But
Sting's...
He'd spent a decade with TNA.
Yeah.
You know?
And there was a reason he's like, you know, like, I want to know why this guy spent a decade with TNA.
Yeah. Like, why? Like, what? Why exactly, like, did he stay with WCW all those years when he probably had plenty of offers to jump ship?
Mm-hmm.
And then in TNA, like, when they're clearly not even close to being, you know, competitors to WWE on a financial standpoint.
No.
Why what did he never jump over then, you know, when he still had, you know, majority of his ability,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Yeah.
Why did it take until he was pretty much just done with, like, he'd mm-hmm. done everything with TNA and he just decided to move on? Like, why did he wait until then?
So as appreciative as I am for WWE for taking the time to put these things together, as much as I enjoyed watching them.
Yeah. Sometimes it's better to get it from a third party.
There's a TNA, there's a Sting documentary out there that's not been made yet.
Sure, absolutely. I did remember what was making me happy.
Alright.
And I remembered why I had it ready for last week and not this week. My favorite band, or one of my favorite bands, is coming out with a new album. And it's supposed to be like the end of their big storyline, The Deer Hunter. They come out with these albums that are all part of this one big storyline, and they're just called Act 1 and so on and so on.
Through Act 5.
And then, like, almost a year exactly after releasing their last act, like, Act 4 was, end of summer 2015. Like, almost a year later, they're announcing that they're releasing Act 5. And it's pretty awesome. And even though they said that it's supposed to be 6, they're saying that this is, at least for now, the last one. So I'm pretty excited to see where that goes.
Okay.
So that's kind of like what I've been nerding out on lately. And I know it's not as interesting as wrestling documentaries on this wrestling podcast, but I'm excited.
Well, good.
Thanks.
I'm happy you're happy.
Yeah, and also we're doing like a big series leading up to the release of like reviewing all the other Deer Hunter stuff. There's some like non-storyline stuff that they've put out that I'm reviewing.
I think as of this time, at least Black and Red have been.
Yes, Black and Red have come out. Next week is Orange and Yellow.
Okay. They have a color spectrum.
And
by the way, they have a series on a color spectrum.
Yeah. Technically it was called the Color Spectrum Deluxe Edition. And the quick thing of the concept is they did 4 songs for each color of the spectrum, like kind of mm-hmm. like the mood of each color, and kind of released them as an EP. They have like a shortened version of it, like just one from each color, and that was just like the you want all of them. It's like 36.
Yeah.
9, whatever 9 times 4 is. 36.
There you go.
Yeah. 36 total songs, and I'm kind of tackling them each EP at a time.
Mm-hmm.
And putting a review up on the Relevant But Awesome blogspot leading up to, and then we're going to get into the act albums, and Q is going to help me out with those. And I believe like this will be his first time completely listening through the act album, so he'll be a little bit more unbiased than I am. I'm going to be in the tank, and I make no apologies.
All right.
Cool.
As always, you can follow us on Twitter at Sierra Attire, who we live tweet all Mondays and appropriate Sundays.
And if you have any questions, comments, anything you want us to bring up on the show, send those over to our email. That's classroomingattire@gmail.com.
We are also on – I don't know why I thought you were going to be doing
so step it all over my ads.
We are also on iTunes. Easy way to follow the podcast. You get a new episode every single week. You could possibly give us a review or a rating of
– And if you have any – no, I'm just kidding. 5 stars.
All right. That kind of stuff would help out the podcast.
And if you
we are also on Facebook.
Jerk. If you're listening to us on InsidePulse.com,
if you want
to
look there, then
leave us a comment on there. We'd love to hear from you.
We are also on Facebook. If you want to look there, easy way to follow Chris, easy way to follow myself.
YouTube.com/user/
You messed it up. You tried to be a jerk and you jerked yourself.
Making up an ad for our YouTube page because we're posting podcasts on our YouTube page.
Until next time, stay classy and huzzah.
Facebook.